Good morning. Good morning and welcome to our service this morning. Welcome to if you are joining us online or catching up later. We have a service later today in the Cardrona Village Hall at 7 p.m. So please come along and join us there if you'd like. The service is followed by tea and coffee. In the week ahead, on Wednesday evening, we start a wee Advent study group. Although study group makes it sound serious, and it probably won't be. More like tea, coffee, and chat. Over the next four Wednesdays, we'll be building up to Advent, reflecting on some of the songs of the Christmas story as we go through. On Saturday is our walk and talk group, meeting at 10 o'clock in the Hall Street car park. Is that right, Ruth? Yes, different, so don't come here. 10 o'clock at Hall Street for a local walk. And that'll be a bit of a shorter walk than normal to make sure you can be back for all the switched on celebrations. And the lights switch on Saturday, and then the parade comes here for some Christmas carols and things. So you might want to join in with all of that. Next Sunday is a busy day. We have our service here at 10:30 a.m. It's an all-age service followed by a lunch. And it's also our gift Sunday. So once again, we're supporting the Family Centre with the work they do in supporting families all around the borders. If we are asking folks to donate cash and vouchers, and those get passed on to the Family Centre, and they use them for lots of different reasons throughout the year, perhaps to give a child a birthday day out or a present, and we trust the Family Centre working with different families to know who is most in need of those gifts and to use them. So the best way for us to help is buying gift vouchers either from Asda or Tesco, or by donating money, which can then be used to buy vouchers. So if you wish to donate vouchers, it helps us if you write on the value of the voucher. Now that you get these, it's all just the swipe cards. If we don't know what's on them, they don't know what they can spend. So if you can write on the value, and donations of cash can go in an envelope marked Gift Sunday, and that can go in a basket that will be at the back or our normal offering basket. So please help in whichever way you can in our Gift Sunday appeal next week. And Julia can give you more information if you want to know about that. Then next Sunday afternoon is our Lives to Remember service at 2:30 p.m. A shorter, reflective service for those who are going through the pain of bereavement. The chance to light a candle in memory of your loved ones. So please do consider if there's people you might want to invite to come along. And then finally next Sunday from 4:30 p.m. it's the Cardrona light switch on. And following the light switch on there, we're hoping to take part in singing some Christmas carols. So opportunities to join us later today, through the week, and lots next weekend as we begin our journey through Advent. So bringing our minds back to this Sunday. And this Sunday, our service is very much themed on our partnership with Tondwe. And so our opening hymn is one I'm told that was loved by David Livingstone, who travelled as a Christian missionary around Africa in the 19th century. In his journal, David Livingstone wrote, "I place no value on anything I have or may possess, except in relation to the kingdom of Christ. If anything will advance the interests of the kingdom, it shall be given away or kept only as by giving or keeping it I shall promote the glory of him to whom I owe all my hopes in time and eternity." So we sing our opening hymn. Please stand if you're able. Number 268, O God of Bethel.
Thank you. We join together now in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you for your limitless power, your sovereign will, and your glory which envelops the whole world, for your utter determination that everyone everywhere should hear and know of your love for them, for the insistent gentleness with which you reach out to lift the fallen, heal the broken, and show mercy to those who long to begin again. We praise you for your great love for us, shown in sending your only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to die and rise again, that we might know salvation to eternal life. We praise you that we can claim him as our own Savior and Lord, and even more, that we can offer him to everyone we meet, because he is Savior of the world, the Lord of life and the conqueror of death. We praise you that as we worship today, we unite our voices with the voices of your global church, joining together to worship you. Lord, forgive us where we have become preoccupied with our own concerns and forgotten the needs of others. Forgive us where we have looked only to our own circumstances and failed to help or to give or to reach out to those in need. Forgive us where our worldview has become too small. And as we hear more today from those who have returned from Tondwe, broaden our vision in line with yours. For all that you have done for us, for all that you have given us in our offering, both given today and given in other ways, we give as part of our response to you. And we ask that you would use these gifts for the furtherance of your purposes and to your glory. And we continue to pray now in the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, which are on the screen, as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, recently we've been asking you to donate tea bags for the Peebles Shire Youth Trust hamper appeal. And so over the last month or two, lots of tea bags have been getting donated. You've probably seen them begin to stack up in the Hall of Friendship. The whole room took on a bit of a tea aroma for a while as the boxes gathered. Well, on Wednesday, the boxes were collected. I've got a photo here. This is Sarah from Peebles Shire Youth Trust that came to collect all the boxes. And she wanted me to pass on a huge thank you to you for all the donations. There was loads of tea bags. And as I was carrying them all to that table to take a photo, and I was fascinated by the variety. So if we go to the next photo, there was Marks and Spencer's tea, there was Tetley tea, there was Tetley decaf, and there was Tetley extra strong. There was Yorkshire, PG Tips, Clippers, Thompson's tea, that was a new one on me. There was all kinds of different tea. And it did get me wondering, as I looked at all the boxes, why are tea bags sold in the quantities they're sold in? Does anybody know? So all the boxes, they're 80s and 120s and 240s. What's that about? They're all multiples of 40. Must be because they're for tea. Sorry. But now it's Marion that has to take the blame here because she got my brain going. How many tea bags did we donate? How many tea bags in total, if we go to the next slide, how many tea bags were on that table? Right, let's go guesses. 15,000, 1,000, 5,000, 3,000, 13,000 is good. Many? 40,000, quite a range. We're in between 10 and 13. 12,000, surely. That's the best answer. Did you count them from the screen? You get my chocolate coins. 12,244 tea bags were donated. You think how much a cup of tea might cheer you up? Think how much 12,000 cups of tea might cheer up families around Peebleshire. That was a great result. It's amazing, isn't it? It's amazing to think you just brought one little packet of tea bags and it gets added to everybody else's, and then we donate 12,000 cups of tea. And then those tea bags are taken and added to all the other donations and makes up a beautiful mixed hamper that's then delivered to a family in time for Christmas. And we all just do a little bit, but we make a huge difference. So well done, everybody, and thank you for your donations. And with that in mind, I heard something else this week, something about where we just did a little thing and it can make a big difference. So our next photo, are many of you in that photo? Do you recognize yourself in the fancy dress parade? Quite a few of us took part in the Games Week fancy dress parade. And we didn't just take part, we actually won a prize. I think were we second place? Second place? Second best group? And so we got some prize money from that. And we thought, well, what will we do with our little bit of prize money? And we decided to try something better. So we handed it on to Dennis, who took it to Tondwe, and Dennis is going to tell us particularly what happened with that next. So if you were there in the parade, this is what your prize money did. I'll let you come to the lectern, Dennis. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Now I understand why Fraser asked me to follow him on this story, my little story. Yes, we won the second prize in the Games Week Fancy Dress Parade, and I was handed a slip of a brown envelope with some money in it from Julie and Andrew Knox. It said, would you please put that to good use in Malawi, in Tondwe? And so I kept it safely, knowing that it wouldn't be too long before something came up, either a crisis or an emergency or an opportunity arose. And a month later, the head teacher contacted me to say that she had 20 children, 20 vulnerable children that couldn't attend school because they couldn't afford uniforms. And I thought, oh, well, that's interesting. That's a good way to spend our money. I wonder what it would cost to make 20 uniforms. So we asked the sewing group that we have out there, what would it cost to make 20 uniforms if we provided the fabric and you provided the labor, which we'll pay you for? And they came back with a sum of 380,000 kwacha. Now, those people that have been there know that sounds an awful lot, but it isn't an awful lot. It's about £180. But our £40 that I had in this little brown envelope wasn't going to pay for them all. It would mean only 5 children would get to school. What happens about the other 15? What were we going to do about them? They would be disappointed if they couldn't go to school because they really want to go to school, these children, believe me. They're very eager to learn. So I put the question to the local Rotary Club, and two of the members, two lady members, came up with a great idea. Why don't we remember what it was like to be school children and have school dinners? That was a long time ago, I thought. And we come to a club meeting with our favorite school dinner. And we can talk about it and to remember the days that we had at school, had school dinners. There was lots of rice pudding and tapioca, bread and butter pudding, all this stuff that people liked. I seem to remember mince and tatties because you could mix it all up. I seem to remember that, but there were lots of other ideas. So we brought the food along and we each paid £10 towards the cost of being there, because that's what we normally do, pay for a meal. And it raised £150. So the £150 plus the money that we got from the fancy dress parade paid for all 20 children to have their uniforms made. And they were handed out just a few weeks ago. I think we might have a photograph of the children. There they are. That's the children in front of the church with their new uniforms, 10 boys, 10 girls, and they were allowed to go to school because although primary school education is free, there's always a hitch or two, and the parents couldn't afford to provide school uniforms because they had a bad harvest the year before, as you all know, because of the cyclone. So that's the story of the school uniforms. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Isn't it lovely just to hear different stories of how we do a little bit and it all comes together? For the children are still in, do you want to show us the new banner that came back from Tondwe? Or you could get some, do you want some young helpers?
Thank you.
Yes, they always work hard to prepare something for us to bring back. And this is the banner that they gave us this time. Now, for those of you that know the Chewa language, you'll know that they can't distinguish between L and R. And they were so embarrassed about it. And I said, don't worry, it's special. It's just how you say it. It's how you wrote it. So that will mean something special to those of us that have been to Malawi. And that's what it says. You can all read that. How good and pleasant is it when brothers live together in unity? Isn't that lovely? So that's for another one for our church corner. And we took the quilt out there, and we'll tell you about that sort. We've got a Malawi corner. They've got a Scotch corner now. So, there we go. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. That's great to share. Lots more stories to come from Tonway. First, we have a song, though, from the children's choir there.
We are going to sing together again now, but we have a special treat for you. We have formed a guitar group. And in our guitar group, there are some people who haven't played for quite a while, and there are some people who play regularly, and we've all kind of come together, and we are going to lead our next hymn. So, if you give us a moment to get ourselves organized. What I would say to you is that as we play, as you hear us, and as you join in singing, hopefully nice and loudly, if there is anybody who has a guitar somewhere that's gathering dust, you used to play, and you would like to join us, I'm sure this won't be the last time that we play together, so please do come and let us know. So I'd invite you all to stand, and we're going to sing together, "Here is Love Vast as the Ocean." If you stand, and I'll play an introduction, and we'll come in confidently. switch my microphone off first.
Thank you very much to you all for playing for us. Well, our children can make their way out to Sunday Club now, and then we'll hear our Bible reading from Shirley.
Psalm 133, a song of ascents of David. How good and pleasant it is when brothers live together in unity. It is like precious oil poured on the head, running down in the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down upon the collar of his robes. It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion. For there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore.
Thank you, Shirley, for double duties. Running back to the desk there. I'm going to hand over the next part of the service now to our Malawi partnership team, who are going to report on all that's been going on and on Dennis and Dave's recent trip to Tonwy.
To start with reading out a letter we got from the session at Tonwy. On behalf of the Reverend James Kigali, executive members, elders, and the entire Tonwy CCAP congregation and community, we thank you, Dennis and David, for your important visit, though short. We also thank Reverend Fraser and the ITW Church for promoting mutual learning whereby schools and classrooms are linked. We are together in business, friendship, development, together as partners for years. We thank you, Reverend Fraser, and your congregation and community in reducing poverty, business, health, and learning together. The school and all the projects are all strengthened due to your assistance. We now have our own farm for food production, though natural disasters We now have our own farm for food production, though natural disasters are there, likely house maintained to mention a few. But we appreciate your support. You never let us down. You're always alert to us. We hope our plans for this visit will be taken note of by God's will. Give thanks to Reverend Fraser and the ITW Church and community. Greet them all for us. Wishing for a nice, safe journey back home. May God bless you. That was from Mervis, who is the session clerk, on behalf of the session. She also gave us a personal thanks. Mervis is the session clerk. She also runs the Chicks for Grannies program, and she's been suffering from a very painful leg for some months. Like everyone in Malawi, she couldn't afford to go to see a doctor, so we paid for her to go and see a doctor and get some medical treatment. And she sent this card: ITW Church, Reverend Fraser and the whole congregation, thank you for your assistance for medical and cash treatment. The help you gave meant such a lot, and hopefully you'll know this comes with lots more gratitude than words can ever show. I'm now feeling better, and hopefully I soon will be healed. Thank you, Mervis. So, just an example of some of the things we do when we're there, and they do appreciate it. Dennis?
I'm going to tell you about the quilt that passed through many hands here when it was made by the lovely women at Crafts for You in Walkerburn. They're in the porta cabin in the car park in Walkerburn, and you're all welcome. If you ask me later, I can give you the times that they meet. They're wonderful people, making lots of lovely embroidered things and quilting things. And we met them at one of the car boot sales when they were selling things, and they agreed to make this lovely quilt that we took out to Malawi. And it went round the town here, and it finally ended up here in church where we blessed it before it left. It went out there, and it went through lots of children's hands in the church and then also into the school and halfway up a flame tree. The children love to climb this flame tree, and especially in blossom. It's a brilliant, bright red colour. So they hung it up there, and I think you can see it back. They're up the tree there, holding on to this lovely quilt that was made in Walkerburn, and it'll be positioned in the church next to the font that is out there that left in a container about 10 years ago, I think, when we sent a container out, the font from Walkerburn Church, so it'll be sitting beside it. It's a wonderful thing that we've done for them, and they are thrilled and they appreciate the workmanship that went into it. Now, next we've got the twinning committee. They have formed a new twinning committee for us to meet when we were out there, and we're going to get to know them all really well. It means that they'll be meeting once a month and thinking about how the partnership can go from strength to strength. I was particularly impressed with this young man, Trevor, who you'll see up there, who is going to take charge of communications, because that's really important that we do share news between each other, because a lot of partnerships fail because we don't talk enough. So this young man stepped up and said he wanted to be called the media officer. So we've got Trevor, the media officer, there now, and he's a single parent with a five-year-old girl called Jocelyn. I think that was marvellous. He's also a Manchester United supporter. So you'll meet Trevor lots and lots of times because he's really keen to engage with us all, and we'll be swapping WhatsApp messages. So that's Trevor and the very, very enthusiastic twinning committee out there. Dave, it's your turn.
As you know, we have the Change for Church. John Taylor collects the pennies and silver and whatever, and a big bottle. And we use that for the health issues in Tonui. It's only pennies, but as we heard earlier, little bits create a big, big, big pot. While we were there, we met with, you can see, the bottom one is Lemek, the top one is Radisson, and then there's Gift, who you know, and a new lady called Elizabeth. Lemek was the guy who had who was recovering from polio when he was a child, had been left with a caliper, which was a rigid caliper. He's had that all his life. It meant he walked with an extreme limp because of this caliper wouldn't bend, and it gave him a lot of trouble. He met with Dennis and Jackie in March, and we paid for him to go to one of the hospitals in Blantyre, and they fitted him with a new caliper, which actually bends at the knee, and he is so proud. He now can walk properly. He doesn't look like he's got a leg that is immovable. He can actually bend down, and it has revived his life with his family as well. Elizabeth, who you see, has sight problems. We met her when we were there. Unfortunately, she was using some local medicine to try to help her sight, and it appears she may have ruined her eyes. But we're sending her to a specialist to have a look and see whether it is cataracts and that can be fixed, or see what we can do for her. Gift, who's the girl who had huge growth on her face and had that removed, she's now had at least 5 or 6 operations since, removing parts of her jaw, putting in false teeth and so on. She is unbelievable. She did all the announcements at the church during the service and the session. She's unbelievable, and she looks very, very nice. She keeps on saying, "Do I look beautiful?" Of course the answer is yes, but she does. It's pure skin, you can't see any marks. All the operations were done inside, and she's a married woman. She got married last year. So, you know, it's very, very important for her. And then talk about Radisson. Radisson, Dennis met. He did a little tour of some of the houses to see what houses still needed roofs, and we'll come across that later on. He met this guy called Radisson, who is suffering really bad mental problems. He was barely dressed. He's living in a hut with a mud floor. Has got nothing to do. He can't work. He can't survive. He's losing weight and blah blah blah. So while we were there, we put a care package together. We bought some clothes. Dennis donated a lot of his. He said he was donating it, but he was actually getting rid of them so he didn't have to carry them home. And Marjorie didn't have to wash them. But same size, roughly. So he got a lot of clothes. We bought him food to take him past Christmas. We bought him some medicine. We bought him some basics, you know, salt and flour and the things that people take for granted, and some bedding. We've also asked our local contractor, McPherson, to look at what it would cost to put a decent floor in the house. And we bought him a chair, so he can sit in his veranda in a nice chair, at least, and feel like a chief. Dennis.
Yes, as Dave mentioned, the wrinkly roofs, if you remember last year, we repaired 4 houses out there that had been severely damaged by the storm. And these thatched roofs don't withstand much. When there's a wind blows and it starts to rain, they leak and the roofs blow off. And they've got to repair them at least once or twice a year. So most people aspire to having a metal roof, but they can't afford it. And we invited the elders out there to identify another 3 people who would benefit from proper metal roofs where we could replace their thatch. And they picked 2 ladies, 2 grannies, who live on their own, although they also do child-minding duties, that could obviously never afford to replace their thatched roofs. So there's 2 ladies there, And have we got some photographs? Yep. We've got Endless Colombera and Bina Binali, two grannies that will need their roofs repaired. And also Kate, a young single parent with four children, Kate Maguire, who will also be requiring a new roof, the wrinkly roofs that we've talked about. And we also met Emmanuel, who had a lovely shiny new roof that was given by us for last year. And he was really proud of it, but he has no windows. So we're going to see if we can put windows in his house. He's got it covered by cloth instead of proper windows. Is it still me?
Just want to mention, as you know, I'm the editor of the magazine. We have sent the magazine out regularly. Every edition goes out to the minister. The current minister, James, does not have Wi-Fi in his house. He gets Wi-Fi on his phone so he can see the magazine. But now that we've been introduced to Trevor, the new media guy from the partnership team, Trevor immediately said, because I'd sent him out the latest magazine, and he said immediately, "Can I get some of these printed, please?" So we've paid for 6 copies. He's in Blantyre at the moment. He can go to a local shop and get 6 printed copies in colour, one for the minister, one for the session clerk, and then 4 for around the congregation, or 1 for the school, and then the rest for the congregation. So they're really pleased. They see their name, and they want to make sure it keeps on going. And he has promised me lots of articles for the Easter version, so Easter edition. So beware, you're going to get a lot more. Yeah, I want to mention this. This is very important. You probably have seen, I mean, you all know about Cyclone Freddy, and you may have seen that southern Malawi is still suffering really badly. An example from us, you know, we have a garden, what the church garden, they call it a farm now. It is a large piece of land. It's over 3/4 of an acre. They till it, they put fertilizer in it, they grow the crops. And normally, and for the last 4 or 5 years, they've managed to grow enough to be able to feed all the people who are hungry in the village, to keep some back to buy fertilizer, to sell it, buy fertilizer, and to keep some back for seed. Freddy wiped it all. They had the fields fully planted. Freddie came and took everything that they had, all the crops. The fertilizer was all used, the seeds all used, so they have nothing. So we are, I'll mention it later, we are looking to rebuild that. But generally speaking, Malawi has now had 2 devaluations in the last month of their money. When we were there, it happened on the Friday. I was talking to Jim on Friday night. The last time I was there, we were getting just under 1,000 kwacha per pound, 980 actually. It had crept up a little bit into the 1,020 and 30 in recent months. On the Friday when we were there, it devalued and we were suddenly getting 2,200 kwacha. Great for us. Dennis and I emptied our pockets and changed it to kwacha, so we could leave them as much kwacha as we could give them. But terrible for them, because it means 50, 60% increases in lots of stuff. Yeah, petrol, yes. None of these villagers need petrol. They don't have anything to drive or put it in. But they do have, you know, needs for food, and the food prices are going up, the cement prices are going up, the fertilizer prices are going up, everything's going up. So one of the things we've decided is for all of those who put a greeting in the magazine this year, you know that we always like, if you can, to give us a small donation that goes to Malawi. This year we're going to put that money towards running a Christmas party for the children. It's 4 weeks away. They're going to have a little party. We're going to buy them sweets and pop and some biscuits and things, some rice and some meat to try and feed them. I think it will put a real smile on a lot of little faces if we can give them something at the time of Christmas to celebrate. So if you put in, can you remember to put in your wee donation? If you still want to do it anyway, just put in donation for the Malawi greetings. in an envelope or give it to Ruth or myself in the next couple of weeks. And that's definitely me.
Thanks, Dave. One of the wonderful things that occurred to us in this last visit was that we had the opportunity to bring together three wise men of Tondwe. Now, these are the three ministers that we've interacted with since we started visiting back in 2016. Although, let's not forget, this partnership, this twinning link, has been going for 15 years. This is the 15th anniversary of the first visit by Janice and Paul back in 2008. So it's been going a long time. But it gave me an opportunity to bring together Picklin Chifulumira, who was the first minister we came together with, Enos Mohiwa, and of course now Reverend James Chigola. So we got them all together and we sat them down. They were a bit nervous, a bit shy. They weren't quite sure what was going to be happening here because they'd never done this before. They don't share very much. It was a learning process for them. But we gave them four questions. The first one was, what has worked? What has been achieved? What has not worked so well? And how to engage the broader presbytery. Now that's an interesting one, isn't it? And I'm delighted that we've got Helen Taylor with us from Stow and Heriot Church, because Stow and Heriot Church were the next church to kind of follow our example and came out, traveled with us and established their own link, really strong link now, with Luatala Church in Malawi. And believe it or not, the Reverend Picklin Chifulumira, our first minister, is going to take over Naisi Church. In fact, he's just started there, which was originally linked with the Gala churches. And the Gala churches are now interested in picking up the old link, and so is Reverend Picklin. So it's all coming full circle and working out so well. So that Three Wise Men of Tondwe was a really interesting experience.
One quick one and then a little bit more detail. Just to say that we are a partnership and mission as well, and the church have asked us to see if we can get more Bibles and hymn books. So we'll be approaching the Bible Society to see what we can wring out of them in the local language, of course. And then Dennis and I had 11 hours on the flight, and then 5 hours waiting in Heathrow, and then another flight back up. And on the way, we thought, we really want to come up with an idea of how to invigorate what we're doing, make it a little bit more interesting, be able to spread it out a bit further. And we came up with the 12 gifts for Christmas. These are at the back of the church. I'll make sure I'm there when you're going out and hand them out. It's a nice picture at the front, which is up there. The second page is a description of each of the items, which I'll go through in a second. And then the last page is the order form. And it's not surprising, me talking about money. But there you go. Part of this came from the fact that my brother, I get a Christmas card from my brother every year. And it says, you just bought a goat in Nigeria. That was a present I was given. I always kept on writing back to him and saying, you know I'm in Malawi. What are you doing in Nigeria or wherever? He says, I'm not supporting your charity. I'm giving you charity. So we have a bit of banter every Christmas. Anyway, the idea of this is you'll see 12 gift ideas. The top one is the wrinkly roofs, which we're saying, you know, if you could give £250, that would put a wrinkly roof on a house. That's the high end, by the way. I'm not going to get worse. But, you know, you can always think about getting it together as a group. It doesn't have to be a single person. The second one across the top, if I just go across the top, is a goat. A goat costs, I don't know where my goat's escaped. It costs £40 to give a goat, which keeps the families going on rich milk and meat eventually. It's a give goat forward. The idea is that they get the goats, they breed them, and the first kid that comes off, the mother, goes to another family, and so they build up. It's a wee bit slower than the chickens. We'll talk about the chickens in a second, because the goats tend to only have one kid a year. So it's a wee bit slower, but it's still mushrooming for us at the moment. Chickens, it costs £30 to buy 6 chickens for the grannies. This is extremely popular in Malawi. We met with probably 17 out of the 19 grannies who now have goats. So again, we only started with 6 and it's expanded. They give the eggs away to their neighbours or their chicks. They eat the eggs, some of the eggs, they sell some eggs. One granny sold a lot of eggs to be able to pay her child, her grandchild in through school. They really, really like this. We have built for some of them what they call corrals, it's hen houses, to protect them, because at the start they lost quite a few with wild dogs and whatever else. But actually, some of them don't want that. They keep the chickens indoors because they've had thieves coming and attacking and targeting the coops and the corrals, quite easy to pull apart, and then they get in and take the chickens. We have solar lights. There are 2 different types. We have light a house for £60, or a single solar light for a child, which is £10. We have an idea of a bicycle. The kits for the menstrual hygiene, which is Lois here? Okay. Which Lois, as you know, runs, that's £10. Fertilizer, I mentioned we have to buy fertilizer this year for the church garden, and that's £30. Maize, we need to buy them maize immediately. We left quite a bit of money to buy it immediately because they lost everything. So they need to feed families now. Girls' education, you know, all know we're doing girls' education. Dennis and I went to see St. Anthony's secondary school that a lot of them go to, and it's tremendous. So £100 puts a girl through 2 terms at school. Dennis mentioned earlier, education, primary school education is free as long as you've got a uniform. Secondary education is not free at all. You have to pay. Very few families can afford it. There's quite a few that go. It's not exclusive. But we're now putting 2 groups of 5 we've got there into different secondary schools, and we're trying to grow that. They also need some textbooks in the primary school. You'll see that £30 buys the full set of textbooks that they need for a year. And finally, the bridge repairs. We built a bridge, as you know. It's not an insignificant bridge. It's quite a strong, heavy bridge. It takes 1,000 pupils from one side of the river over to the school every day and back. If they don't have that bridge, which they didn't for years, they either have to take a risk of going through the river, and when the water's high, they can't, or they have to walk around. It's about 2.5 miles, and they walk because they've got nothing else to do. They have to. They can't go in a car or can't get a bus. They have to walk. So we built that. Cyclone Freddy hit. The new main stanchion in the middle withstood it. The bank on this side, the side of the school, withstood it. The other bank got eaten away at the back, and it's partially collapsed. So it needs some urgent repairs, and we were all taken down to the bridge to see it. It needs some urgent repairs, and then Dennis and I are going to have to work on a bigger program for longer, probably with Rotary more than anything else, to try and replace the bridge top to something other than wood and something a little bit higher to even withstand Storm Freddy again if it comes. And it's next one. So these are at the back of the church. I'll be there to hand them out if you need to. Please have a look at them. There's no strong arm tactics. It's up to yourself. Take them. If you don't want to do it, it's not a problem. But let's see what we can do. Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Dave. And just to add to that, the children in the Malawi group at St. Ronan School are going to be preparing the thank you cards, as will 1 or 2 children in Tondwe School preparing thank you cards. So if you do want to get involved, you'll get a card to pass on to someone who you are gifting that to. The last item we have on here Lois would have joined us today, but she sadly couldn't be with us, but I spoke to her on Friday and she gave me the information. We're going to be providing menstrual hygiene kits made locally by the sewing group out there for 150 girls in the primary school, because if primary school goes up to age 15, so they've got 150 girls that will be selected by the head teacher to receive these menstrual hygiene kits that will allow a girl to go to school for 3 years. So that's, they're going to provide the fabric for the sewing group to make these. So that's us all done now, I think. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you.
Thank you very much for so much to report back on there. As we reflect on that, we have another song, this time from the Guild Choir in Tondwy. Your chance to sing now. And we sing a hymn that's based on the verse that's on the new banner, and the verse that was in our reading. The hymn is called, "Oh, How Good It Is." Stand if you're able.
Together in spirit, in faith and unity.
How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. For there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore. Today is a great reminder that our church isn't just the church in Innerleithen. It isn't just the church in our parish of ITW. It isn't just a church in the Church of Scotland. But we belong to the Christian church around the world. And that we have so much in common with our Christian friends around the world, and particularly we're thinking today about Entondwe in Malawi. The folks there are part of our church family. They are our brothers and our sisters in Christ, and we seek to live in unity with them. I want to say a huge thank you to the Entondwe Partnership team, to Dennis and Dave, for all you've shared with us today, and the encouragement it is, the joy it is to share in worship from another church. And it's so good to say 15 years of this connection and to continue to build on that. And that call to live in unity is something for each and every one of us. And that unity starts here. It starts with the folk who are sitting around you, in front of you, behind you, to the side of you. It doesn't always come easily, but we choose unity. We make a conscious choice to be united together in our faith, to choose to build up our relationships together, to choose maybe that the conversations that we have after church, that we support each other, that we encourage each other, perhaps that we are vulnerable, we share something of ourselves so we get to know each other better, and we build on that unity rather than just being individuals who come and go to an event. And we seek to take that unity out into the world and to our partnership with Entondwe. So do have a think about how you might respond. It might be through the gifts that give back appeal and you can do some Christmas shopping. It might not be financial. You might want to just commit to praying for a particular project. There might be something that's just connected with you in one of these projects and one of these people that you've heard about that you want to speak to Dennis and to Dave a bit more about. As Dennis said, it's the wonders of technology. There's quite a few folk in Entondwe keen to keep in touch with us by WhatsApp. And people are keen to build on that relationship, to build on the unity that we have with Entondwe too. So encourage our partnership team, show an interest, ask about the projects and see how you might be involved. There's loads to pray for. There's loads to remember and loads to think about. But as we'll soon have that verse hanging on our wall, to think about that God looks and says how good it is when his people live in unity. His people, that's us together and in the global church around the world. When Dennis and Dave went out, we sent a prayer with them, a prayer that they led in the church service on the Sunday that they were there. And so we'll pray that together now. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the joy of coming to you in prayer. We're amazed that you are the Almighty God who created the world, and yet you know each of us, and you love us. Hear our prayers now, we ask, in Jesus' name. We pray in partnership with ITW here and with the church in Entondwe. We thank you for the unity that we share in Jesus Christ, for we are all one in Christ Jesus. We give you thanks for the shared journey together, for a partnership that has grown over many years between our churches and our communities. We thank you that we can learn from each other what it means to follow Jesus, that we can be one Christian family together. We pray your blessing on Reverend James as he ministers to lead your church there. We pray too for the elders and all in leadership. May you give them wisdom as they serve you there. We pray for both of our churches. We pray you would bless us, that both churches might be filled with people ready to follow you, to love you with all their heart, soul, and mind. We pray for wisdom for the partnership, for all the different projects that we've shared and for the plans that we are making. May you show the way forward, Lord God, as you help us to make progress together. We pray for both of our communities, for our schools, our teachers, for our children, for our health centres, our doctors, our nurses. May you continue to show us how to work together, to care for one another, to love one another, to serve you always. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we sing our closing hymn together, number 519, Love Divine. Go in peace and unity, and may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.